Lord God, Heavenly Father, as we come to worship you today, we realize our need for you. You are our righteousness, our holiness. You are our rightness for our lives. You have given us so much through your Son, Jesus Christ, who opened his arms wide on the cross. So as we come to you this day, Lord, we know that life is better. Each day is better. The 24 hours that you have given us are better because of you. Our lives rooted and built up and yoked to you, Lord, we can do anything because you are everything to us. Open our hearts and our minds to hear your word this day. In your name we pray. Amen. Mary Beth. And he wants us to have a good day. He wants us to trust that he is in the day with us, and that we ought to trust that he is there to provide with his presence and his provision and his providence. We've been talking about this. But some days are just bad days. Nothing goes right. This woman, you know, vacuum cleaner works, doesn't work. How many times has that happened to you or me? Maybe you guys not so much, but we women, you know, we're vacuuming and the vacuum cleaner falls apart or whatever. Or the needle, losing the needle, or when you're sewing, you know, getting milk or juice spilled all over you. We've had bad days. and nothing goes right, and we'd rather crawl back in bed and pull the covers over our heads and not get out again. So what do you do? What do you do when you're having a bad day? When you're out of gas, when you're out of steam, when you're out of energy, you're zapped, you're sapped, and you have nothing left to draw on, and you're frustrated, and you have nothing left that you can draw on to handle your problem. You're overwhelmed. What do? And the day's not even over yet. Some days we feel just overwhelmed and frustrated and tired. We feel like we're on that hamster, you know, that hamster wheel. We just keep going and going and going. And maybe you have to work during the summer. Maybe you have to work. And the kids, a lot of the kids are out of school like this summer. Maybe some of them are in camp. But you worry about your children and if they're okay and they're wandering around. And what are they doing when you're at work, whether it's during the summer or in the school year? They're bored. What are you going to do with them? Maybe it's taking care of an aging parent or parents and trying to figure out if they're okay. Maybe they're a distance away. We have a number of you that you know, are going into Queens and all over Long Island to take care of your aging parent. Maybe the bills are piling up and the bank account is dwindling. And maybe it's all the little things. I had one of those days yesterday, about an hour, where I had all these little things were piling up on my to-do list. I didn't want to do them. It was a beautiful day, right? And then they're piling up, and as you check one off, the list keeps growing. And it's frustrating, right? And you just want to say, throw up your hands. And maybe there are just too many demands on your life, too many expectations for you to do something or for your time. And sometimes the day goes on the blink. It just goes on the blink and it turns out all wrong. You can't see the end of the day. You're just trying to muddle through. Or maybe you feel absolutely tired and just worn out. And the covers are calling you to climb back into bed, or to climb on the couch and pull the quilt over your head. Or perhaps you're having a day where you just don't even want to get out of bed, right? We all have them, but God certainly does not want us to have a bad day. He doesn't want us feeling this way. He does not want us faking a smile. He wants us to be glad and rejoice in it, in the day. He does not want us falling apart, falling to pieces. Jesus said it this way in the gospel reading, the reading that's done in the center of the aisle. Come to me, you who are weary. Come to me, you who are have heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. He says, come to me. Come to me. We forget about our Savior in our day. We forget that he's really waiting for us to come to him, for us to turn to him, for us to partner with him, to bring our problem and our pain, our predicament to him. Instead, we take on the problem and the predicament, the trials and the troubles, and we try to figure it out ourselves on our own. Let me tell you a story about the disciples. I was thinking about this. They tried to solve a problem on their own without inviting Jesus into the problem. Let me set this, you know, they were on the hillside, the sun was going down, and the day was cooling off, and there were about 5,000 people on the hillside that were listening to Jesus as he was teaching about a new way of loving God and honoring God and how to live honoring God and loving one another. He was teaching, it's called the Sermon on the Mount. He was teaching and spending time in the crowd. It was getting late, and the disciples are looking around, and they're saying, well, the sun's going to be down soon, and they don't have provisions. They weren't expecting to stay the whole day, but now it was time to eat. There's no 7-Eleven around. There's no Chick-fil-A around. There's no Panera's around or McDonald's, or, you know, there are no stores around, and so the people had not prepared for this long day, so the disciples decided to solve the problem themselves in their own way. They go to Jesus and they say, Jesus, it's getting late. No one has food. Send them away. Send them away so we can, and then we can get some rest. And they can fend for themselves. Send them away. That's a good way of solving the problem, huh? They forgot to consult Jesus first in their problem and ask him, how do we solve this problem? They have no food. Well, Jesus uses this as a teachable moment, and he told the disciples to go and gather whatever food, whatever provisions are about around them. And they came up with some fish and some loaves, not enough to feed 5,000 people. You see, Jesus knew what he was doing. And the 5,000 people, after the food, the fish and the loaves of bread were blessed, those 5,000 people ate. And guess what? There were leftovers. You see, God knows the way. Jesus has the way. Jesus is with us in the way, if we include him. By the way, this is not the first problem that the disciples tried to solve on their own without Jesus. They saw Jesus solve a lot of problems. Remember, the wine ran out at a wedding? Well, what are we going to do? Jesus solved the problem. When the storm raged while they were out on the sea, what are we going to do? We're going to die. Jesus solved the problem. When the boat was heavy with a great catch of fish, and it looked like the boat was going to sink, it was taking on water, Jesus solved the problem. They didn't know what to do. The disciples' mistake, and very often our mistake, is not getting the problem to Jesus, not getting our challenge to Jesus, not getting our struggle to Jesus. Giving Jesus no part in our problem, the problem remains in our laps, our struggle, and the day has no chance. It just remains a bad day. God is able to do what you and I cannot do. He's already working behind the scenes, whether we know it or not, or experience or not, or sense it or not. God is already working behind the scenes. But he wants us to partner with him and give our problem to him so that we can partner together in solving the problem. He wants us to acknowledge that we need to be trusting him and acknowledge that he has a better way than we do. We don't give him the problem at the end when we've exhausted all the possibilities and the ways that we have tried to solve it. Oh, send them away. They'll get some food somewhere else. No. We partner with God, with Jesus our Savior. He is asking us not to wait until we're tired, until we're exhausted, until we've tried every avenue to solve it, to deal with it. He's asking us not to wait until we feel empty and lost and depleted. Jesus wants us to call on him in prayer. He wants us to give him the first shot. Get it to him first. He wants us to come to him when we are burdened, when we are heavy laden. And I will give you rest. But the rest of the gospel, verses 29 and 30, he says, now, I want you to take my yoke upon you. And let me teach you, let me lead you, because I am gentle and you will find rest for your souls. So come to me when you're burdened and heavy laden. I'm going to give you rest. And the rest comes in being yoked to, attached to, you know, oxen with the yoke and the wooden yoke that brings two oxen together so that they can work together in concert to plow the field. Well, that's what Jesus is saying. It's about partnering with the Heavenly Father, our Heavenly Father. It's about partnering with our Jesus, our Savior. It means we are yoked together. We are walking together with our Savior. We're plowing the day with our Savior. We're plowing the day with our Savior, with His strength and His guidance, His encouragement, His presence, and His provision, and His promises. And so the prevention of a burnout day, a bad day, is to call upon Jesus and get the problem to Him, partner with Him, be yoked to Him, seek Him first, follow His lead. Because God is not bewildered by our problem. He's not stumbled by our problems. There is nothing beyond His understanding. There's nothing beyond His ability to provide for us. I have plans for you, says the Lord. Plans for good and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. If you're having a bad day, come. Find rest in Jesus by being yoked to Him. And He's going to guide us, and we'll plow through the day together with our Lord and our Savior. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You that Your Son Jesus Christ has taught us a way to live 24 hours when we would rather stay in bed and not live those hours, just stay quiet and not get out of bed, not live to glorify You and bring You glory and to enjoy the day that You have made and to rejoice in the day that You have made. We'd rather pull the covers up over our heads and just shake in bed or sleep it off. But Lord, You have given us a way to live out a bad day, and that is by being yoked to You, giving our day to You. Maybe it's better if we just start the morning, Lord, praying to You to say, here, take my day, Lord. Have it Your way, and I will try and surrender to You. Heavenly Father, we thank You for our lives, for each 24 hours, for each day of 84,000 heartbeats. We thank You, Lord, that we have loved ones in our lives, people who care about us, support us, love us, people that are there to encourage us when the day gets bad. Heavenly Father, we come to You in prayer and praise and thanksgiving for all that You have done for us and have given to us. But Lord, there are those among us who are ill or hospitalized. For those people we know and do not know, we offer them up to You right now as we pray. We pray for Catherine and her back surgery, Hannah and a broken arm, and Nova with stitches, and Jessica with brain issues, and Susan.